as time goes on, the non-collectivist, freedom-loving sector will get more and more members. And a significant chunk of them are, and will continue to be, former leftists. That's not a bad thing or a good thing in and of itself, but one needs to be prepared for this influx. So, let's look a bit into the psychology of the former leftist. Hello everyone and welcome to the Freedom Alternative. Okay, so this video is inspired by a comment left by the user Neil Orange Peel, subscriber and fan of the Freedom Alternative. And Neil says, quote, "The left are volatile and angry. This is why they get away with things they really shouldn't. However, many like me have moved over the past 2 years from the left to the right. I think it means right as incorrect. We still have that fire. I've been biting my tongue, I've been close to dragging people wanting to marry into my family, such as my sister's liberal boyfriend, out by his neck. Well, he did say Lee Rigby kinda asked for it during a meal for my mom's birthday. He brought up this subject, not me. As an ex-boxer and about 60 pounds above his weight, he's lucky I bit my tongue for my mom's sake. My point is that you now have many angry former lefties seeking the truth. I think I understand why you are being calm." Now, for those of you who don't know, Lee Rigby was a British Army soldier who was murdered in the streets of London by two Muslim savages, and links about the incident in the low bar for those unfamiliar with the case. Okay, so, while I've been promising for a while that I'll make a video with 5 practical ways to deal with the leftist, it's perhaps better that I haven't been able to do it so far, as this video will be a good preamble to that. As in many other videos, I insist upon making the difference between a leftist and your average person who votes Labour or Democrat or SPD or whatever the mainstream incarnation of leftist lunacy is in your country. The leftist is an ideologue who in many cases knows he's an opponent of freedom and a supporter of savagery and violence against people who disagree with them. But your average person voting for the leftist, in many cases, does not know that. Moreover, your average person voting for the leftist has been persuaded at an emotional level that those who disagree with the leftist narrative are inherently bad people. I mean, why else would you disagree with free healthcare for granny if you're not a bad person? Why else would you say that Islam is evil if you're not a racist? And I'm not joking here. Many people genuinely think in these terms and have wholeheartedly swallowed the feel-good mythology that flows non-stop from the cathedral media and the generalized leftist media complex. Now, is it, at least in part, their fault too for swallowing the leftist nonsense? Yes, it is. But think about it this way. Most people don't have the luxury of having the time, or let's face it, the intellect, to sift through all the nonsense and get to the closest possible representation of the truth. To make things worse, even those who do want to do that still face a harsh task ahead of them, as the universities are highly corrupt and the pop culture is barely even worthy of its name anymore, as it's neither pop nor a genuine culture. It's an emotionally driven narcissistic cult. That's what it is. And it is what it is also because of the non-leftists who have completely surrendered the pop culture to the collectivists instead of taking it seriously and fight tooth and nail for it. Now, what's that got to do with Neil's comment and the issue of former leftists? Let me explain. You know, unlike other times, the pop culture of today, and especially its stars, are far less diverse, if you pardon my phrasing. And this is particularly true in the English-speaking world. Think about it this way. In France, when the raving socialist president François Hollande insisted with his 75% hate tax, a portion of the culture lashed out at the opposition saying that those who disagree are unpatriotic, or some similar nonsense like that. But here came along Gérard Depardieu, who said, "You know what? I did more for this country than any of you clowns, and you don't get to call me unpatriotic. When I was making France proud and known around the world, none of you clowns ever even existed. You know what? Here's my passport. I'm out of here. Good luck fostering growth with this insanity." Now you may say that his choice to embrace Putin's National Socialism may not have been the most bright decision, and it wasn't, but that's another story for another time. What Depardieu did was to signal within the French and Francophone culture that no, it is not unpatriotic or evil to oppose far-left Leninist-inspired economic policies. He also signaled that too much is too much, and that maybe it's not such a bad idea for the most productive and smartest people in the country to just leave and let the angry leftists deal with the results. And as I covered in several videos in the past, the results weren't pretty, as more and more rich people engaged in an exodus, many of them inspired by the high-profile pop culture figures who just said no. The politicians don't admit it now, but they'll soon have to admit it, and the next administration will have to find a way to persuade all those smart and rich people to come back, or to adopt policies that would facilitate the emergence of new smart and rich people. Now, you tell me, where's the Gérard Depardieu of the English-speaking culture? Where's the Gérard Depardieu that went to Obama and said, "You know what, fuck your Obamacare, here's my passport, I'm done here. You're not gonna steal from me anymore. This is sickening and way too much." Where's the British Gérard Depardieu to go to Cameron and say, "You know what, enough is enough"? Where's the pop culture support for Brexit? That, my friends, is the sign of a non-diverse pop culture. And when the pop culture is so universally monolithic, the side that owns it gets to do whatever it wants. And one of the main things that it does now is to push anger. Now, you do have 19-year-old kids being angry about slavery. That's not normal. 100% of the people living today in North America were born into freedom. You have 21-year-olds angry about white cis men in Britain, with the net result of young white men being the most hated upon group in the country. That's not normal. Someone taught them that. So when Neil says that the left are volatile and angry, he is of course correct, but one needs to remember that they're not naturally volatile and angry, but they've rather been conditioned to be that way. However, them being volatile and angry is not the reason they get away with things they really shouldn't. The reason they get away with things they really shouldn't is the existence of the safe space and the power of manipulated people in big numbers. Let's take the violence at the Trump rally as an example. When everyone you know believes the same things, has been educated by largely the same people holding largely the same views, and your direct leaders have been bought by largely the same people, or maybe I should say the same person, you really don't get any outside view. You're in a safe space. So when all of you gather, you don't get to hear from anyone, "Hold on a second, let's at least hear what Trump has to say before going full fascist and full savage here." And that's how they get away with things they really shouldn't. Now, in a subsequent comment, Neil tells us that he's been gradually moving away from the left because of calm UKIP voting friends, and because of him noticing the increasing of anti-Semitism within the left, as his World War II veteran grandfather had warned him that in times of crisis, there's a lot of Jew-blaming to go around, and he should watch for that. Now, all of that is fine and dandy, but Neil's case is quite far from typical. Most people don't leave the big leftist tent out of principle, and especially not out of concern over anti-Semitism. Most people leave the leftist tent when it affects them personally. It shouldn't be that way, but I didn't write the rules. The left is now more or less a cult, and unless you get to feel the burn personally, no pun intended, you're very likely to start looking for alternative points of view. Think about it for a little bit. Who is the most likely to be a leftist? It sure is, and people like Neil, who have a personal family connection with history, like knowing his World War II veteran grandparent and having at least a semi-functional family. Just look at your average leftist. Your average leftist is likely to have or to have had a dysfunctional family, usually single mother, very likely to hold a bullshit degree in this overinflation of degrees, and is quite likely to have one or more personality disorders. Now, barring the personality disorder part, which is a more complex phenomenon, the other two main characteristics occurred because of leftist policies. Single parenthood has been steadily on the rise thanks to the leftist anti-father and anti-male narrative combined with the perverse economic incentives to make single parenthood an attractive option. The mythology that everyone can and should go to college has brought a rise in bullshit academic programs in which quite literally new leftists are being bred. Speaking of breeding leftists in the academia, a week ago, I had a self-described social justice warrior calmly explained to me that it is anti-science to believe that there is such thing as anti-white racism because all experts agree that white people don't experience racism at all, and racism is thus axiomatically exclusively against non-white people. Now, how do you argue against that? Well, the answer is that you don't. Such people are usually woken up by something personal. Just like the former feminists who woke up to the insane misandrist cult's nonsense after they spent some time in jail over a false rape charge, or someone dear to them had his life ruined over a false charge taken as a fact under the listen and believe policies. And many, or I would argue most of the former leftists that are now looking for alternative thought are of this category. The people who've gone through a shattering shock that forced them and their consciousness to stop and ask, wait a second, what the hell am I doing? Look, it would be nice if more leftists could be swayed through calm debate, but given the nature of the modern left, that's rarely the case. And in the cases where that happens, it's rather a happy exception and sadly not the rule. This is, for instance, why I advocate baiting leftists in public and arguing them with the purpose of convincing the audience and not the interlocutor. The leftist in the audience is very likely to react emotionally, and if you can touch the emotions of the audience, the interlocutor has already lost the debate in the eyes of the audience, no matter what he says. This is nothing new. It's how the left has been winning since there has ever been a left. By telling a story that touches the audience and not the interlocutor. But unlike other non-collectivists, I have no qualms in using their own weapons against them. Anyway, so, how do we prepare for this new influx of former leftists? Because this wave is coming, the left has become so bloody insane that in 5 to 10 years' time, it will be a stain in itself to have been associated with the mainstream left. As Neil said in his comment, the left have become the new far right, whether they realize it or not. You may think I'm exaggerating now, but remember that politics follows culture. 10 years ago, it was unimaginable to have figures like Douglas Murray, a right-wing homo who doesn't care if the Muslim feelings are hurt. Merely 5 years ago, it was unthinkable that professional conservative provocateurs like Milo Yiannopoulos would not only exist and have an audience, but grow so big that there is a tour over universities and colleges in 4 countries called the Dangerous Faggot Tour. Say what you want about these kinds of people, but they make conservatism cool. The culture has changed, and the effects of that are yet to be seen. Think of organizations like Students for Liberty, which didn't even exist 10 years ago and now has chapters on all continents except Antarctica and is enthusiastically supported by your average people, not just students. In 10-year times, as the culture becomes even more globalized, and it will, all of these things will start to matter. So knowing this, it's impossible, it becomes practically impossible to provide one single answer to the question on how to prepare for the influx of former leftists, because the answer depends on what drew the individual to alternative thought or what pushed the individual away from the left. Some people are drawn to liberty-oriented thought because of the excesses of feminism, others because of the excesses of identity politics in general, some more others because of mass Islamic immigration, as they discover that multiculturalism has a different meaning for the chattering class than what they understood it to mean. Others become interested in liberty once they travel a bit more outside of their bubble and realize that the overwhelming majority of the planet is completely uninterested in things like microaggressions, cultural imperialism, the white cishet capitalist supremacist hierarchy, now you try saying that with a straight face, or a plethora of other issues that meaninglessly occupy the time of the intellectual leftist. For all these different kinds of people, there is a separate approach to welcoming them in the big and growing tent of normal, liberty-loving people. Now, I won't get into every category, but I will emphasize this. When you meet a former leftist like this, make sure to introduce him or her to the alternative thought on the topic that pushed him away from the left. Someone who just, well, left the left because of their insane economic program, for instance, is very unlikely to be interested in hearing why microaggressions are a bullshit idea, but is very likely to be interested in learning about more about free markets, limited government, and freedom of association. Someone who just left the progressive bubble after growing sick of the left's kowtowing to non-white people, who in the progressive mind can never be wrong, might be more interested in learning about the harms of affirmative action and the soft bigotry of low expectations, rather than hearing why intact families are better, and so on. What I'm saying here is that rather than toning down our own message to appease the former leftists, it is a better strategy to just change the order of the delivery. Oh, and one last thing. The anger that the former leftists bring with them is not a good thing or a bad thing in and of itself. We need angry people, we need funny people, we need serious people, and everything in between. As far as I'm concerned, one should let the anger consume and fade itself rather than try to actively suppress it or do something about it. The facts are heavily against the leftist lunacy, and facts don't have time for feelings. But the way they're presented can indeed help on convincing certain kinds of people. You know, there is an audience for alternative thought expressed in an angry manner. Besides, sometimes a well-placed, "No, you're wrong, fuck off," simply is better than explaining to the flat earther why the planet is round, or explaining to the feminist why the wage gap is bollocks. And with that being said, thank you for watching, and I'll see you around on Freedom Alternative.